I/O that depends on that BPF, which is the Berkeley packet filter, how it interacts with PF packets. And then I use this base toolkit that is called NestMethodG.
So just to give you some background, in your daily work as a kernel engineer or also maybe as a sysadmin, it is quite useful to have the raw access to the network packet. So to look at it, to look at the protocol headers, if maybe something is wrong there, for instance, a checksum or whatever, you can also use this for protocol development to check if it actually does what it should do, or to monitor your traffic that goes into your network, for security auditing, like intrusion detection systems, and many more stuff. So yeah, to accomplish that, to have a look at this data, the Linux kernel provides basically two socket families for that. One is PFENet, and there you have the socket type socrar, so raw sockets. And the other thing is pfpacket. There you have socdecram, socdatacram, and socrar. So for both pfinet and pfpacket, and pfinet in socrar, and here in socdatacram, you have only a partial look at the header. So you won't see, for instance, the Ethernet header. But you can do this with pfpacket and type socrar there. And this is what we're going to focus in our talk, how this works. So in the real world, who's using this? Who's using pfpacket with the raw facility? Actually, the most popular libraries among those users are still pcap, packet capturing library. Maybe some of you have heard of it. Basically tools like tcpdump, Wireshark are based on top of that. Also the network port scanner, nmap. Then you have some intrusion detection systems like Snort, Bro, some other cool utilities like dsniff, hping, passive OS fingerprinting tool, POF. Then you have kismet, for instance, which is a wireless sniffer, or aircrack. Yeah, and all those kind of tools are using libpcap and therefore also this socket. And then you also have the NetSniffNG toolkit, which I'm going to be presenting later. And of course, many other projects in the proprietary industry we might not know of. And so basically, it is serving a huge user base, pfpacket. So just to give you a minimal example of how this works, I cut out the header inclusions. So for instance, here you allocate a socket, as already said, in pfpacket and socrar. Here you basically say that you want to have all the packet data, so only IP packet data, so you do not care about other things. And then you can do on the socket some receive from calls on a buffer that gets filled with that. And also you can do a send to. So here you will receive every possible incoming packet because you do not give any arguments to that function. But for the send to, you say that you only want to send this data that you receive back to the loopback device and send it out those raw packet data. So it is maybe quite a simple example, maybe not really useful, but it can get more complicated. So let's say those issues that you have or that you can run into with the simple example is that, yeah, for each and every packet you have to call send to, receive from, so this gives you additional context switching and buffer copies between user space, address space, and kernel space. And AFPacket actually provides some nice facilities to further improve the performance there. So for instance, one of this is zero copy, which means that you do not have to copy buffers from user space to kernel space and vice versa, also called packet mmap, as in the title of this talk. And there's quite a nice book, which is called Network Algorithmics, and you could categorize that into the avoid obvious waste principle. So just avoid copying this stuff and you can maybe improve your performance. Another feature is called socket clustering that AFPacket provides. This basically means you can have multiple processes having separate sockets actually, but they are working together. So then you can, for instance, pin those processes to particular CPUs and then use the AFPacket fan out. This is this socket clustering facility. And then, for instance, based on the RX hash, it gets only to CPU 1, a particular flow, or to a different CPU. So to basically to exploit some locality and to leverage off those components that you already have in your system if you have an SMP system, for instance. And you also have socket filtering, in other words, the Berkeley packet filter, which I will talk about later. So you don't need to look at every particular or at every single packet that is incoming, but just filter it right in the kernel, let the kernel do the stuff, and not the user space, so which you can categorize into shift computation and time, because you do not want to process all this stuff all the way up to the user space, but just do it right there if you already can do this. So how does this AFPacket architecture look like? In particular, the memory mapped I/O facility. So there are two different things, the RX and TX path. And for the receive path, I will be going to show you how the packet will walk through the kernel up to the user space where you run your PFPacket application. So here, we will start here at the NIC. At some point in time when you receive packets, it will issue an interrupt to the CPU and say, hey, I want to be processed. So the kernel looks up in its do IRQ function what particular handler is registered to this IRQ number that just came in. And it will call the device driver stop half routine, which does some very simple processing, only arbitrary in time because it has to exit as quickly as possible. So if this driver routine was implemented by a new API, then it will schedule a software interrupt for the receive path and return to let the kernel do some other things. And at some point in time, the kernel software interrupt daemon, which processes, for instance, timer interrupts or also networking stuff, it will be executed with do soft IRQ, and then it will invoke for the networking part the receive routine, which is called net RX action. And this particular function, it will basically pull those device driver implementations or pull handlers, and they will look if there are some packets that are batched up to schedule and to process, because this will do all the expensive part that we cannot do in our interrupt handler. So this will basically process the packet to the network stack, and most likely this pull handler will then call netf receive skb, which will then, for instance, process the packet to netpol, or it will process some VLAN stuff, and also protocol handlers. So, for instance, if you have UDP, TCP, stuff like that, it will look it up and deliver it to the correct handler, which is then going to a particular socket, for instance. And in our case, we have a AF packet socket, so it will be given there as well, in addition to if we have already a TCP connection somewhere. And this will be delivered via deliver SKB. And based on the I/O method in AFPacket, it will either call tpacket receive or a different method, which, for instance, uses direct I/O. But in tpacket receive, we have a ring buffer that we have memory mapped. So that is basically a shared buffer between kernel space and user space. And this tpacket receive will prepare the incoming packet for that, for instance, for a particular slot in the ring buffer. But before that, it will call, it will do some filtering, some Berkeley packet filtering, if we have a filter attached, of course. Yeah? And so then you can drop packets early if you do not want to see them or if you do not care about them. And besides that, it will fill some metadata for your memory map ring that you can use. For instance, time information, VLAN information, stuff like that. And then it will copy the packet content into one of the three ring buffer slots. And into user space, which you have here, you have an application running. This application can, for instance, call the poll syscall so that it does not need to have a busy loop over the whole ring, for instance, but the kernel will notify a user space application if we have some data available that you can read. Then it will wake it up, and then user space application can have a look at each and every slot if there's some data to process for it. So this is quite useful because you do not have to do a system call each time if you receive stuff, and you do not have to copy or packet between address spaces. Yeah, so this is the receive path, and transmit path looks quite similar. So here we start from user space application, and it already has a ring allocated. I think you're already quite familiar with it from my last slide. And here it's the user space application's burden to fill also some metadata into the ring, in a free ring slot, and after that also packet content that you want to send. So you have a raw Ethernet frame, things like that. And after you have filled a particular amount of free slots, for instance, then you can call the send-to call, which will then just trigger the kernel and return afterwards immediately, so you don't have to wait for it. And this is just a trigger to notify, okay, now it is your turn to process things. And in kernel space, it's via the tpacket send routine, and it will scan over the ring slots and look if there is something that he has to process. And if so, then those frames or pages that you have filled will be set as SKP fragments. And then the kernel will call the main packet send routine that is called devqxmit. So this is for transmission. And yeah, in devqxmit, so now we basically left the AF packet area or AF packet layer, and we will go to the lower stuff that is more towards the driver, to the drivers. And devqxmit will basically, if you have a virtual device like a VLAN or maybe tunnel device, something like that, it will right away call dev hardstart.xmit, which will then go to the driver. And at some point, the driver, which is just a virtual device, will then again call devqxmit on the real device and the real underlying hardware. And when it does that, it will enqueue the packet to the traffic management layer, which, for instance, Jasper was talking about, where you have different routines like this CODL routine, for instance, or other things. And yeah, depending on the load and other properties, the function qdisk run is called. It depends. It can also lay itself to sleep, and at some point in time, a software interrupt invokes this function. And yeah, so yeah, it is all based on your traffic management policy, basically. And then at some point in time, it will call dev hardstart.xmit, and probably it has to linearize the buffer that we sent here, that we set here as fragments. And then it calls the driver function, which is called ndo.xmit. So then we say, okay, we don't care anymore. It's now the driver's part to process it. Yeah, so this is basically how it looks like, the packet processing path. And as I've already mentioned, in the input path, we have filtering. So the Berkeley packet filter, This was introduced in 1992, and it's still actually the architecture that is mainly used on Linux and BSD for filtering packets in the kernel. Also, there have been many other alternatives, but this is the one that has been implemented and used. And obviously, it was introduced by Van Jacobsen as well and Stephen McKenney in a paper. The architecture basically, it's like a small machine. You have an accumulator, which is a register that is 32-bit wide. Then you have an additional temporary register, which is the X register. Then you have a memory store. It's basically just an array of 16 elements, and I guess this one is not used so often, but nevertheless you have it, and it was concepted in this paper like that. Then you have a BPF program, which is basically a small program that you have hacked or generated by a compiler. And for this, you have an instruction pointer that points to one particular line in this program, and also an instruction decoder that looks, okay, what is this one now, and what do I have to do with this? And then you also operate on some data, which is the packet content itself. It's SKB data. And then you can do anything or lots of things to analyze it, and then to say in the end, okay, just drop it or let it pass to upper layers. For instance, here this basic encoding. Here you have the instruction. So what it has to do, for instance, load a particular byte from the packet or store it into X or A. Do a comparison, do a jump, all those things like that. Here you have two offsets. One is jump true and the other one is jump false. So for instance, on conditional instructions, like here, like on this line, those have actually a value that is higher than zero. And then it says, okay, you have to jump in your program if the condition is false, three more entries below me, something like that. And here only one. And K is actually only used as an argument. So for instance, if you have a comparison operation, then you say, okay, I want to compare it against this and that hex value. So it's like an immediate value that you give to this BPF program. Yeah. And for this, the implementation in the Linux kernel is in netcorefilter.c. So it is in the core networking. And yeah, the implementation of this architecture is in the function sk-run-filter, or is triggered from that, so you can look it up. And quite an interesting, here you can basically say it is a huge switch statement that says, okay, if this particular instruction is, then do this and that, and blah, blah, blah. And recently introduced also by Eric Dumasey, he built a JIT compiler for that. So which means if you, from the user space, load such a BPF program into the kernel, then there's a just-in-time compiler, which means it reads all those instructions that are actually just interpreted within this function, and then it emits some opcodes, you know, like GCC, like this compiler, for instance. And yeah, and he wrote the implementation for x68, and it is quite interesting to see. And then also implementations for Spark architecture, PowerPC, ARM, and S390 from IBM, they have involved later on. And yeah, it is really interesting to look into this code, and you can learn quite a lot. I've also submitted a couple of patches for x68, Spark, PowerPC, and ARM, and it's quite funny. So regarding those instructions, you have a couple of different families. So you have some load instructions, store, branch, conditional jumps, and you have some other instructions like addition, subtraction, whatever, and return. With this return instructions, you basically say, okay, I want to keep this packet, or I want to keep only parts of it, so you can cut it, truncate it, or you just drop it And you also have some misconstructions, like for instance, copy value from X to A or vice versa. And the Linux kernel also has some additional extensions that are not mentioned in this paper from 92. For instance, access the CPU number that we are currently processing in and put this into the A register, because all the calculations obviously are done in A, in the accumulator. Or for instance, put the VLAN tag. If we have a hardware accelerated VLAN, then put this tag into A and then do some processing with it, like compare VLAN IDs or something like this. Yeah. All of this is also used in the NetSniffNG toolkit. So now we are going up to the user space a little bit and see how this can be used in real life. And the NetSniffNG toolkit is quite a nice collection of useful programs for daily work as a network developer. It consists of a couple of programs, which are NetSniffNG, so the program itself. And it is a packet analyzer. It can also record packet traces, so PCAP files, and it can replay them. Then you have TrafGen. It is a traffic generator that uses as well this PF packet facility. Then you have AS Traceroute, which is autonomous system traceroute. It will show you some geographical information and as well autonomous system numbers. You have CurveTun. It is a small IP curve elliptic curve tunnel. So you can do encrypted communication for that for IPv4 and IPv6. Then you have IFPPS. It is a small top-like tool that shows system networking statistics. BPFC, Berkeley Packet Filter Compiler. I will talk about it later. Then you have FlowTop, which is also a top-like tool like IFPPS. And it can show you current connections. So it uses connection tracking, and it will tell you what kind of program on your system is generating this flow. And also it will display you some geographical data to, for instance, if you're connecting to the US somewhere at some place. And then you have Mausezahn. It is actually an English translated mouse tooth. It is also a traffic generator. I will also speak about it a little bit. Yeah, and core developers of this project. There are two maintainers. One of them is me, and then Tobias Klauser. He works at the University of Zurich. And I recently asked him if he wants to be a co-maintainer, and he agreed. So he also did some good contributions to it. Then we have Markus Ament. He was doing, or his work was financed by the German flight security. They were doing something with IPv6 and multicast, so they sponsored him to do some work on NetSniffNG as well. Then Emmanuel Roluit, he was my former colleague when I was working as doing my master studies. Then Christoph Jäger, also from Germany, and John Schipp, who is a system administrator somewhere in the US, and he mostly cares about documentation, which is quite nice. And if you want to use it, you can just go to GitHub and clone this project or download it. Fork it and work on it as well. And it was basically started in 2009. I started it just for fun to have a look how does packet analysis work and how it is actually done, and maybe also how to do it a little bit better or a little bit faster than they were used to do it this at the time. And it's in GNU GPL version 2, so yeah. And for the rest of this talk, I will be concentrating about TrafGen, Mausezahn, IFPPS, BPFC, and NetSniffNG, and I will also give you some real-world examples how you can actually use it or what has been done with it, for instance. So I think I already mentioned it, but just to give you a short categorization, it can be used to traffic generate, to capture it, measure it, yeah, as you've seen, AS Traceroute, FlowTop, IFPPS, to encrypt traffic with CurveTun, and so on and so forth. But now we are going to concentrate on TrafGen for a while. So it is a fast, multi-threaded, low-level network traffic generator. As already said, it uses the TX ring architecture that I presented earlier. And it has a very powerful packet configuration syntax. So anyone who knows the packet gen traffic generator knows that it's quite, or it is not really possible to configure some certain types of packet payload that you want to have, only some more high-level stuff, but not everything. So yeah, and this is why you have then, for instance, TraffGen as an alternative that runs in the user space. And on Gigabit Ethernet, the performance is actually quite similar to PacketGen. So it runs in the kernel, so it is quite, let's say, maximum you can get. And Gigabit Ethernet, for instance, for a 64-byte packet size, you get almost 1.4 million packets per second. And for instance, this line here is for Mausetown, which uses normal syscalls, and so it is a little bit slower. Yeah, so at least for 10 gigabit per second Ethernet, we have to still evaluate it. There was no time left yet, but it's for future work. Some examples how to use TraffGen. I will go into details about configuration language a bit later. The usual or the normal working mode that you can have is you just define a device where the traffic should be going out. You give it a configuration file. So this is a file with the configuration language in it. And then, for instance, you can run it through the C preprocessor to do some textual replacements. And on default, it is running on all of your CPUs. Another example is, for instance, how you can inject raw 800 to 11 frames, so raw wireless frames. So, for instance, if you give it there as a device VLAN 0, and then you can add a parameter that's called RF raw, and then it will put automatically in the background the wireless device into monitor mode, and there you can also transmit raw frames and, for instance, I don't know, break your access point. And yeah, as well, a packet configuration, and you can also specify maybe if you have four CPUs that you only want to use two of them. And another interesting thing that is added into TraffGen is that you can do device smoke or fuzz testing, which means basically that you have a particular packet configuration where you just generate some random data and see if this machine is still responsible after each packet that you have sent to it. So I guess it might be pretty hard to break the Linux kernel with that, but maybe some proprietary devices that are not well tested, you can run this against them and then see if they still react. And if they don't, then TraffGen will print the last known packet where it wasn't responsive afterwards anymore, again with the random seed that was used, and so on and so forth. And you can also use, in combination to TraffGen, some traffic control disciplines like NetM, for instance, to introduce some random bit errors or some delay, stuff like this, because we have seen that AF packet will call DevQXMIT, and therefore it will also pass the traffic management layer. So some real life example, again from Jasper. he used TraffGen to generate a UDP fragmentation denial of service attack. And he also, so basically he was using this to stress test a remote machine and regarding its IP fragmentation performance and cache line behavior. And you can read more about this on this particular link. I also put up the slides on netsniffng.org. And yeah, he was submitting some patches to the Linux kernel that got accepted. And I'm not going to focus on what he did in particular, but you can read this up about how this configuration looks like, for instance. So I modified it a little bit because I wanted to show you some more features of it. So you can include a standard defined file which is shipped with TrefGen, and it has some includes like ETH, P, IP, which is the define for the IP protocol. And so this means it runs through the C preprocessor before TrefGen actually sees this configuration file. With this, you can say CPU 0 to 1, that you only want to schedule this packet. If you have, for instance, a machine with 4 CPUs, then you can say only CPU 0 and 1 should transmit this packet. The other 2 shouldn't care about it. And then if you have those braces, an opening and a closing one, then this means you have one particular packet that you want to define. So you can also define multiple packets in one configuration file. And then you can start hacking some raw bytes in hex code, for instance here, MAC destination and source address. Or you can use some defiance from the C preprocessor. And if you use, for instance, const 16, then this means this is a 16-bit with 16-bit wide integer that automatically is replaced into big endian. And you can also, as you can see here, I'm not going through everything, but just mention something, that you can also define bits itself. Here you have a particular function that is called DRND or dynamic random. This means that on each run through, TrefGen will generate some new random numbers for those 2 bytes in this packet. So for instance here it was the IP ID which was used in this fragmentation attack. And it can also calculate IP checksums, UDP checksums, TCP checksums, stuff like that. You can also define, for instance, those IPs in decimal and stuff like, yeah. Then you can say, I want to have just a character or some particular, either a string or some shell code that gets then translated into bytes. You can say, okay, I want my next 11 bytes filled with 41 hex code, or yeah, just some string. So it is quite flexible what you can configure with that. And because it's just a simple text file, you can also do some higher layer scripting, like write yourself a Perl program or yeah, and to generate some more advanced configurations like particular packet distributions that some vendors usually use to test their things. Then you have Mausezahn, which is more of a higher layer traffic generator. It is basically intended that you plug this in somewhere in a powerful network box, and you can test your devices like this, and it has a Cisco CLI where you can just tailnet into it and then configure your packet and then say, yeah, send this through device X or device Y. So it is quite useful. FPPS, I will just go through this a little bit faster. It's just a tool to read out procfs and to display useful statistics. For instance, what some people use is IP trough. Maybe some of you have heard of it. And basically, it uses the PCAP to capture the traffic, then it will analyze it. But the problem with that is that this is really time costly, and if you measure something under high load, it can falsify your statistics. So because of this overhead. So for instance, if you use FPPS, you will see 1.4 million packets per second, where actually IPTref will show you some false number. And it will also display you interrupt numbers, interrupts per seconds, and software interrupts. So quite useful. It can also do a GNU plot data output if you want to plot something. Yeah. Berkeley Packet Filter Compiler. As you've already seen regarding the architecture, this is the tool that can translate an assembler-like language into those opcodes that you have seen in the previous slides. So for instance, this example, it will load some header, it will compare it and drop it, for instance, if it's not IP, and so on and so forth. So this is, you can write the programs in that. It was implemented with Flex and Bison, and then you can load such a DOS opcodes as a filter, for instance, into NetSniffNG. It also can use higher level filters, but just for debugging purposes, for instance, for testing those just-in-time compilers, it is quite useful. And to show you another real-life example from that, from Markus Kötter, he used BPFC to prove such a just-in-time compiler bug for x68 by writing an exploit for it. I will quickly explain how this exploit works, because it is quite interesting. He used TCP dump, this particular filter, and he noticed, okay, something weird is going on if it gets translated into actually opcodes. What in particular is happening? In BPF language, you have some jumps. It really doesn't matter what is here, but you have some jumps, and if they are translated into assembler or into opcodes and you disassemble them, then you will see, okay, for this jump offset, it should actually jump to 10D, but my next comparison instruction already starts at 10C, so it is basically off by one. It looks maybe in the first hand pretty harmless, but we can do something funny with it, because in this x68 JIT compiler, we have pointed to SKB data in register 8. And what we can do now is to increase this register 8 by 42 bytes for a UDP packet, for instance, and then it will point to your UDP payload. And then you can call into R8, which means then you will execute the packet payload. And to do this, you have to trigger this bug multiple times, to encode this stuff here. And yeah, and BPFC was used for this. I mean, just to go very quickly through it, here's how it looks like. So it does some particular load. It doesn't matter what it loads. Then we do a conditional jump because we want to trigger this off by one bug, and this can only be triggered on long jumps. This is why we do some padding here. And when we arrive here, we will arrive by off by one, which means instead of this comparison, we execute parts of this integer that we want to compare to, actually. So which means here we move from register 8 to register 10. I think he used that to maybe because R8 is at some point in time later overwritten or something, but I think it was not useful, but he didn't need to. But anyway, he is doing this for if the condition here is true and also false. So you have basically two times the same execution. Afterwards, you do another long jump, which will result here, either here or here. It really doesn't matter because it's then the same code executed. And here you will add those 42 bytes in R10, which will then point to our UDP packet payload here as well. And then you do another jump, and you will end up encoding the call of R10, and then you will execute the packet payload. And yeah, when you put this into a debugger, then you will see if you create a packet with particular instruction that it will also get executed. So yeah, quite shit happens. So it is a pretty unrealistic filter in real world, you have to say, but just to point you to that, does JIT code need some more security review? Because bugs can be really fatal that look just harmless. I will just, NetSniffNG, I will just quickly go over this. NetSniffNG is basically protocol analyzer, pickup, recorder, and replayer. Some examples for that, you can use it similar like TCP dump, but it is actually faster for recording PCAPs and replaying them. So for instance, here you can record a PCAP from ETH0 device. You can also replay raw 802.11 PCAP files that you have recorded with NetSniffNG. You can also use traffic control again to do some things with it. So what's next? I will be skipping this due to time constraints. But yeah, you can just go to the website, hack on it, download the source code, and submit patches. Don't be shy. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask, either right now or afterwards. You can just come to me and ask things. So thank you very much.